Hi, you're watching Schenectady Today in and around the Capital Region. This is a very special show. We're doing it on August the 14th, which is the Armistice Day of World War II. And the actual signing wasn't until September, I think September the 2nd, for the actual end of the war, but the armistice was on August the 14th, and that's why we're doing this show today. This show is about Richard Marowitz, who has passed away, and he was the man who found Hitler's hat. The important thing is that he found it right after visiting Dachau, and that was in Munich, where he went into Hitler's apartment. But you'll hear that whole story right here on the show, so please stay tuned. You're going to find this very fascinating.
But right now, I have Richard Marowitz with me, and I am so pleased to have him on the show. Actually, he sent me a little thing, and what a handsome kid he was, too. You were, what, 18, 19 years old in that picture?
I think
they're going to be showing it up there, maybe.
In this picture, 19.
You were 19, okay. How'd you get in the Army?
I was drafted.
You were drafted, just like everybody else?
Yeah, I signed for the draft in Dallas, Texas. I was on the road with a band.
With a band?
I was 18. I got into the Musicians Union in New York, Local 802.
19 years old,
I got into the union when I was 16, and I was doing club dates around New York City when I was 16.
Wow. What'd you play?
Trumpet.
Trumpet.
And then I went on the road with a band when I was 18. Not when I was still 17, when I was 17, and I turned 18 in Dallas, Texas, and I signed for the draft there.
You had to be 18 to sign?
Yeah. Yeah. And you better sign when you're 18.
Yeah, oh, okay.
And got a call from my sister that I sent you a questionnaire, fill it out and send it to the draft board as fast as you can.
This was one of those greetings letters you got.
Oh, yeah. So I did that, and I got a call, you better come home. Of course, they want you at the draft board, and she gave me the date. So then I had to call New York and get somebody to take my place in the band, and I needed somebody my size so he could wear my uniform.
Oh, my. Now, there's your picture. And, what a handsome kid you were!
And it was kind of crazy. And I was in the Army so fast I didn't even know what happened.
Right, and then you ended up in Munich, of all places.
Well, that was near the end of the war.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what brought you to Hitler's apartment? Come on. Well, I mean, is there a big sign? This is Hitler's apartment.
I was in a peculiar platoon called the. For short, I and R platoon, actually it stands for Intelligence and Reconnaissance, but they let me in anyway. I was a point scout on the point jeep. There was only 28 men in the platoon, and our regimental INR, and our job was to go to the command post early in the morning, usually around 5, and they'd give us the mission for the day, and we had to go. The job basically was go out in front of the regiment, and if the regiment is point, you're in front of the division, and find the enemy, report back location, composition, etc. Take prisoners, interrogate, bring somebody back.
But this
to
was after the war, wasn't it?
No, this is before.
This is before the war. Okay.
This is before.
During the war.
And. And it was a little bit on the hazardous side.
Yeah, I guess so.
We had a 75% turnover. We were the first ones in Munich in April 29th, 1945.
April 29th, 1945. Okay, I'm trying to place my dates.
Actually, we smelled it before we got there. And then nobody told us that, about concentration camps. With the smell, we thought were dead animals in the field.
That was Dachau.
And we got to Dachau. We were pinned down because we were so far out front, and it took a few hours for the troops to catch up to us. And then a tank came out of Dachau, and we thought it was one of our. It was one of our tanks,
but it wasn't operated by.
But no, the Germans were in it. It was a captured tank, and when it came out, we were getting up out of the ditch. And the gun came down on us. And fortunately, one of our own tank destroyers came up behind us and knew it had to be a captured tank and blew it away. That was the first time I ever kissed a tank. And it was an awful mess. It was just terrible.
Humans. Did you go into? Did you go into?
Well, there was a.
It must have. I mean, I know you're Jewish.
Yes.
This has got to be.
It was upsetting.
The most. I was going to say. I don't even know. I was looking for a word more than upsetting.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
But I don't think I could find one.
Yeah.
I mean, it was upsetting for everyone, but to know.
Yeah, all the guys were thrown up all over the place. On a siding alongside the camp, there were 40 boxcars of bodies they had just brought to the camp to burn. And we found one man alive in all of those.
Oh, my God.
There were piles of bodies all over the place. The ovens were there and all the other tricks that they knew how to put people away with. It was just a mess. There were two young Jewish boys from Greece that had just got there shortly before we did, maybe a day or two before we did, and they came out of the camp, and we didn't want them to get caught in the crossfire because we had a little rumble with the SS troops who were holding the camp.
And
we grabbed them off the road, and we actually took them back and gave them to our mess sergeant to feed them and, you know, mm-hmm. put some weight on them. And Sadowski was great with the kids, and he had them do little things around the kitchen. And there were two of them. One of them, after the war, got to, when the division started to break up, we took them to a DP camp, displaced person camp, and kind of put them on the road to wherever they wanted to go. Mm-hmm. And one of them got to Canada and died, and we don't know the circumstances. The other one, Marcel Levy, got to Israel, we found out later. And one of my guys, Sid Schaffner, who had to go to a wedding in Israel, and something
connected
happened.
Connected,
and they got connected. And that was in June of 1995. In July of 1994, July is when we have our reunions. And that year it was in Seattle. And Sid said, you know, I found Marcel last month. And he told me the story. And since then, we talk on the phone and we email each other and so forth.
And email, yeah, wonderful.
And oh, yeah. It's a lot cheaper than those phone calls.
Oh, yeah.
And. It's been nice. And my daughter had to go to Israel on some kind of a mission a couple of years ago. And I gave her the information on Marcel, and I gave Marcel the information on Roberta. And they connected, and they called from his house. She was at their house for dinner. It was really nice. She said they are the nicest people she ever met. And he took me into one of the rooms in his house, and she said, you would not believe it. I said, why? He says, it's a shrine to the 42nd Division.
That saved him.
Yeah. Yes. So it was great.
So now getting back to the Hitler's apartment.
Well.
How did I do that?
Yeah, how did you?
Well,
I told you what we were doing, right? I told you what kind of a nutty platoon I was in. So we were called into the command post the next morning. Now, Munich is 9 miles from Dachau. That's all. And there were two German civilians there, men, who, as it turned out, were spies. They had been sending out information to us. And so they were going to take us to Hitler's house. This was early in the morning on the 30th, the next day. And we said, well, who's there? They said, only SS snipers.
Oh, okay. Well, that'll be easy.
Okay. So only one platoon, 12 of us, in three jeeps, went into Munich. And they said, if we have any trouble, if you see a lot of guys in white armbands, they're on our side. We did not have much trouble. We got to his house, banged on the door, and he had an English housekeeper.
Oh, that's incredible.
Called us ruffians. And why was everybody so mad at Mr. Hitler? He's such a fine man.
He's such a nice man. Yeah. He makes such nice wine.
He was a doll. And And we were all a little bit upset about the day before at Dachau.
Yeah.
And so,
how did it, just to back up just a little bit, because I'm trying to get this in my mind. You have Dachau is 9 miles from Munich, and the Germans, many of the Germans claim they didn't know what was going on.
Yeah.
You're
yeah.
telling me.
Like, I don't know you're sitting next to me.
I mean, you're talking about, you know, the horrible things, the boxcars, the smells, all that. How could the people not know what was going on?
Well, the people that were living in the village of Dachau, which wasn't 9 miles away, said they didn't know. What we did was took all of those people and we made them go through the camp.
Good.
And watch them all get sick. And but you couldn't even find a Nazi in Germany then.
Oh, right. Yeah, they're gone. We don't know where they are.
Yeah.
I think they're in Argentina. I'm not sure.
Yeah, somewhere, yeah. They all took the same plane.
Yeah.
And so we went through the house. And we all ran into different rooms to search. We were looking for intelligence. And we didn't know the war was almost over. And I ran into a bedroom.
Now, had Hitler committed suicide by then?
No.
No, he hadn't. Okay, he was still alive.
He was still alive. I ran into a bedroom which turned out to be his. I opened up all the drawers. The place was beautiful, by the way. It was not ornate. It was just, well, you know, nice taste, pleasant, nice, you know.
And well, everything. You know, like the producers, Mel Brooks says, Hitler was such a nice guy.
Yeah, but you could tell that he took the best furniture and paintings.
Oh, sure. Where did he get them from?
All over Europe.
Yeah,
yeah.
Right.
And
sleaze.
But everything was in place. And the drawers were empty. His people had taken his personal stuff out. I opened up the closet, and that was empty. And I saw something dark on an upper shelf. As I dragged the chair over, climbed up, reached in, and pulled out this gorgeous silk
And you
cup
brought hat. It with you. Let's yes. take a look at that, too.
Yeah. And I was...
Is it made out of beaver skin? No.
No,
it's just
tough. I looked inside the hat, and I saw his initials, A.H., in big gold letters.
Oh, and, my gosh!
And I put two and two together, because I wasn't totally stupid.
Let's see. I mean, Hitler.
And I was so mad from the day before, and I could swear to this day I could see his head in the hat, and I threw it on the floor and jumped off the chair onto the hat and smashed it a few times. And that's,
Look at that.
This is the hat.
I'm going to hold it up.
This is the hat.
I don't even know, should I hold this thing?
You can hold it.
Yeah, I'm going to hold it up just so you can see the initials,
Let me open it up a little bit further.
Okay, whoops, we're moving it a little bit. Sorry.
It's okay. Now, you want to hold
okay,
it?
Okay, like that.
Got it?
Okay, good. Dick is working on it there. There's Adolf Hitler's initials. I'm almost... hate to think that I'm touching something that he did.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, he didn't have a very big head, did he? Except in his own mind.
In his own mind.
Yeah, I mean, really. That's just...
Yeah, well, it's beat up. It was in the basement.
Well, I mean, if you jumped on it a couple times, what do you think's going to happen to it?
It was in the basement for 50-some-odd years, and I just, you know, I didn't talk about it. I didn't do anything with it. It just laid there in a paper bag. I'm surprised it looks as good as it does. And I was talking to a friend of mine who was a past national commander of the Jewish War Veterans. This was in the synagogue on a high holidays.
Okay.
And of all times. And he was then, at that time, he was president of the National Museum of American Jewish Military History in Washington, D.C. And he said to me, Rich, I keep meaning to ask you, do you have any souvenirs for the
Yeah, I haven't had Hitler's head.
I didn't think of it.
Oh, really?
No. I said, I have some leaflets that the Germans dropped on us to give up, because we were always all in trouble every day.
Yeah.
And I have some, a hat and a dagger and a Luger, which you can't have. And it's a lot of other junk, you know, knives and brass knuckles and whatever. He said, well, good, how do I get it? I says, I'll give it to you.
Yeah.
I don't need it. It's just laying around doing nothing. He says, and that's it? I says, oh, no, I have Hitler's hat.
He about just died.
Well, he said, you know, I, no, he didn't really. He said, you know, I can't, I can't stand you. You're always kidding around, even in times like... So I says, no, I said, no, Nate, I really have it. So he says, then what can they, what can we, I said, what do you want to do with it? I says, I won't give it to you. I'm not going to donate it to the museum, but I'll let you borrow it. So he got all excited, and the next thing I know, there was a meeting at the JCC in Albany, and 6, 10, and 13 all showed up, and they were playing the sound on the radio, and the next day they were showing it again, and it seemed to be like a pretty big deal at the time. And I got a call from the museum shortly after that. They said, don't send it down yet. And I said, why? They said, because 3 skinheads walked in. And they said, of course, they're all on the internet, too.
Yeah.
The KKK. And they all get along fine. And they said, we understand something came down from Albany, and we'd like to see it. So they called me, and they said, don't send it down. I said, why not? Well, we're going to beep off security and redo the cabinet that it's going to be in. Instead of glass, it'll be Lexan, and we'll add some steel to it, and we'll call you when it's ready. And they did, and then it went down, and it was supposed to borrow it for 3 months, and they kept calling, can we have it a little longer, and a little longer, and a little longer. And it lasted there for 2 years through 3 or 4 exhibit changes. And they said they never had anything in the museum that got as much action. People would look at it, read the supporter material, go away, come back to it again.
Well, we only have 3 minutes left. Can you believe that? But I do want to mention this book, which has your picture on the front. And it's called,
Into the Dragon's Teeth.
Into the Dragon's Teeth. Battle of the Bulge.
Battle of the Bulge.
And what we'll do is we'll go out on the DVD that you brought.
Fine.
We have about 3 minutes. We'll
To mention there's also a film made called Hitler's Hat.
That's right, and I did mention on my website, but there is a film called Hitler's Hat, and if you want to go to my website, you'll find that website on there, and also in my newsletter, I certainly have written that up too. So. And it's called www.hitlershat.com, and that was on PBS.
Yes.
But this book is written by Dan Lynch and Paul Rutherford, and it's called Into the Dragon's Teeth, and it's about the Battle of the Bulge.
Yes.
We're going to see, we're going to go out on this DVD that he did bring, and before we do that, I want to wish you a very happy Thanksgiving.
You too.
Thank you for coming.
Thanks for asking.
So wonderful to have you on the show. I feel as though I've kind of gotten closer to this whole thing. So we're going to be seeing a little bit about the book Into the Dragon's Teeth, and when we come back, we'll be saying Happy Thanksgiving. Now, Richard was on our show a while back, maybe a month or so ago, and he's the man who found Hitler's hat. When he was on, we had a wonderful interview, and he told me that there was a documentary done about the hat. So we kind of put our heads together and decided it would be a great thing to show, have Richard come back on the show again, and we'll talk a little bit about the Hitler's hat, and we'll see the documentary. So you'll be seeing the documentary that was done by Jeff Krulik, and it's a fascinating documentary, and Richard, of course, is such a fabulous interview, at least I think. So Richard, welcome.
I'm happy to be back with you.
I'm glad. I'm glad you're back here and you brought the hat with you.
Yeah, I thought you might need
it. This is the hat. This is the hat. The real hat that stood on Der Führer's
head.
Noggin.
Yeah, whatever you call it.
Yes, this is the hat. And I'm going to, while you're doing that, Zeb, I'm going to flip it and just show the inside where I think you can see, there it is, that there is the initials of the gentleman that wreaked havoc in the world. But this is a momentum that certainly has been in museums and has created a kind of a new life for you in a sense, right? Because you found it.
Kind of has its own life.
Yeah.
It drags me around. You know. and the reason it's in the shape it's in is because when I found it, I was standing on a chair, and I jumped off the chair onto the hat and smashed it because I was a little mad because the day before I found that we liberated this camp of Dachau, mm-hmm. the concentration camp. And then it spent, you know, over 50 years in a basement in a bag because I didn't talk about anything. And
Like many other returning veterans.
And then now for the last 10 years, we've been going to schools and talking to the kids, and so I'm still dragging the hat around, so I'm surprised it lasted as long as it did.
Well, it's a memento, and it's certainly interesting, and I know that the last time that you were here, it was like I had trouble touching it. I touched it today, but it was sort of like all this kind of washed over me, this whole... World War II experience. It was like, oh my gosh, you know, this is just incredible. But it's just a hat.
It's a hat.
It's just a hat.
It's a beat up old hat.
A beat up old hat. But it was worn by, and I told somebody, and they said, well, Hitler never wore a hat like that. But there are pictures, and we'll see them in this documentary, that he indeed did wear a top hat. He was a bit of a dandy.
Yeah. A dandy nut. It does shake up people. I had passed it to, I was in 1995 at a reunion, and I brought the hat to the reunion because my guys hadn't seen it since 1945. And they persuaded me to bring it. And wherever we go, usually a Holocaust group shows up to interview us because of Dachau.
Mm-hmm.
The guys were running around in the lobby taking pictures of each other with this nutty hat on. One of them came back and gave me the hat and said, thanks, Rich. And there were two young women there. And they said, what is with the hat? I didn't know who they were.
Yeah.
They were daughters of survivors of the Holocaust who came to interview us for their organization. I didn't know that. And I handed it to one of the girls, and she jumped back about 3 feet and started to shake. And I said to the other girl, what's the trouble? And then she explained what the trouble was. And some people get an extreme, you know, being a daughter of a survivor.
Well, I wasn't, and it affected me that way. Yeah,
but,
so.
But, you know, I didn't know. So there you are.
Well, we're going to take a look right now. We're going to show the documentary. We will leave our microphones up in case we need to comment on something in this. But this documentary called Hitler's Hat was produced by Jeff Krulik, and it was shown on PBS. So we're fortunate enough to have that film. So, Greg, if you could show the film.
Can I have
a few seconds? Sure.
This Jeff Krulik is a genius with these oddball types of
things. Yeah, I know. This is
marvelous. He can mix things up and get away with it. And his two producers, Diane Bernard and Ann Petroni, those three were so gentle and nice to my guys when they came to this reunion and filmed most of this that they put everybody at ease. And they are just a marvelous, marvelous trio.
Well, we're very fortunate that it happened and it's been documented. So. Let's take a look at that, and as I said, we'll leave our mics on. We might comment throughout it, but maybe not, so we'll see.
1944 gives way to 1945. In Belgium, Allied fighting men struggle on. On the Atlantic, merchant mariners are busy. A Marine somewhere in the Pacific is very tired. A Navy gunner wounded in action, and overseas, many of his brothers in arms will never see the new year. 1944 was a costly year. Its casualties have paid for great victories, victories that have blazed in the headlines.
I and our platoon ran into an ambush, and I guess five were wounded, five captured, four killed.
It was dark, couldn't see a thing. I happened to have a German flashlight with me.
We had two squads. One was always in the lead, one always in the rear. And I was in the last Jeep in the whole column was what it was known as the getaway Jeep. And in the event we ran into a problem, such as we did that night, it was our responsibility to get out of there if we could, go back and get help, and come back and see if we could help those people that were in trouble. And that's what we did.
Anyway, about seven of us, we all jumped out of the Jeep and we began firing back at the Germans, attempting to fight our way out of this deal, whatever it happened to be. We really didn't know because it was 3 o'clock in the morning. We didn't know how many were there.
We were fairly close because we could hear the Germans talking. One of them threw a concussion grenade, which luckily didn't have the shrapnel shield on it. And it lit right in front of me. I could see it spinning there. And all I did was lower my head and let my shoulders and helmet take the blast. Still have ringing in the ears.
We crawled up a little embankment, and I could see some figures in the moonlight at the crest of a hill. And I began firing at them, and one of the people yelled out to whom I was firing at, "Don't shoot, I'm captured." It turned out to be Stanley Ordowitz, one of our guys.
When I got back to where we were ambushed, I saw nothing. But we soon found out when we patrolled up to where we'd been initially shot at, we received a lot of fire from the Germans who were still there, unbeknownst to us, and we lost another man killed right then.
This was somebody from your INR?
It was a fellow named Morris Tyler. He had been a three-year man at VMI. He was at PFC and a great guy, and he died. He and I were right together. We weren't 2 feet apart, and he was hit through the chest, and I tried to drag him back up to the road, and he helped me for a while, then all of a sudden he stopped helping, and the guy was dead.
After this episode was over, and we went back to our base, it turned out that we had, maybe 4 or 5 men killed, and 4 or 5 men captured, some wounded. So out of 28 men, I think we lost about half of them killed and captured.
I might mention, most of the guys don't know this, but that night we were shot at, there was a German that was coming up the road with what we call a burp gun. It was night, but all I could see was his shadow, and he had come up right in line with our Jeep. This is before we took off, and he had this burp gun on his hip, and he was spraying up and down the road. And he didn't see us, apparently, and we had a 30 caliber machine gun on our Jeep, and I managed to get back to the Jeep. And he didn't see me, but I saw his outline, and I gave him a burst, and I must have cut that kraut right in half. So he didn't shoot anymore.
It's hard to talk about the things that happened, about shooting people, killing people, you know, and then what helped you cope with that?
Nothing that I remember. We just knew what we had to do and did it. As far as I know, there was nobody in our group that ever refused to go.
From Nuremberg toward Munich, the Nazis had fought a rear guard action, briefly defending, then retreating to the next. Hot in pursuit came the Rainbow Men. They were now heading directly south from Munich with the last serious obstacle overcome. The route of their advance headed directly toward the most famous of all German horror prisons, the concentration camp of Dachau.
It's a village of Dachau. They gave us new maps and they said, go to Dachau. We looked at it, we said, okay, we're going to a village. Nobody told us about a concentration camp. We had no idea that there was a concentration camp. We didn't even know what a concentration camp was. So this was a total shock.
And I remember that we gathered around, had a fire going, and our platoon leader, Lieutenant Short, was there. And he talked about, we have to make time today, we're going to not take prisoners. If you see people surrendering, tell them, just point to the back so they'll know that they are to keep moving back. We want to keep going. We don't want to get into firefights because that'll delay us. We just want to keep running. And with that, he pulled out a bottle of booze, real booze. And we only got 7 or 8 of us around the campfire, and we all took a slug.
My particular squad came under fire outside of Dachau. Don't remember exactly the name of the place. However, I do remember it was a courtyard with a barn.
I went to the front door And I pounded on it. I had a BAR at the time. And I pounded on the door, and nothing happened. So I threw a grenade into the, there was a front window, and I was able to throw a grenade into the front room. And the walls, the door was so thick, there was no danger of shrapnel ever coming back through it. And finally, I heard footsteps, and the door gets thrown open, and there's a farmer there. And I checked the rooms in the lower part of the house, and there was nobody there. But as I turned to go out, there was a little trap door, and I saw it up maybe an inch.
And somebody picked up the trap door in this house. I don't know if they told you this story. And they looked down, and the whole cellar was full of German soldiers.
That trap door flew open, and German soldiers started to come out, one after another, and then civilians. And as Richie says, there was a dog that also came out of there. I don't remember the dog.
I can see it right now. The mother and the father had buck teeth. The daughter had buck teeth. I looked down at the dog, and the dog had buck teeth. And I thought that was the funniest sight I'd seen all day. Of course, I was tense. But it cracked me up.
The photo that you see is of the boys in the platoon getting ready to go push on into the city of Dachau and then on to Munich.
I think the strain of all of the action that took place on the way to Dachau shows in those faces. There's no smiles, there's no nothing, there's just a dead shot. If you look at the right side of the picture, you'll see Fritz. He's standing out there alone with his M1 hanging
right
down.
Next
and
to the
in back of him all is right, a whole gang of German prisoners. Since Fritz speaks well, you know, German very well, we said, you know, he's the one that takes care of the prisoners because he speaks their language.
We flushed out an SS man who was of a high rank. I, again, cannot recall exactly what he was, but I would, it seems to me he was an Obersturmbannführer, which is a quite high animal. He had highly polished boots and immaculate uniform, and he told me that he wanted to be treated as a prisoner of war under the Geneva Convention, and I told him to go to hell. You are not going to be treated as such. You get up there and stand at attention on that manure pile, where is where I put him.
I noticed that he held his hands above his head rather oddly, and I called him in off the manure pile, and I asked him to open his hand, and he had in his hand concealed an SS ring, which hid his identity, because we were not tolerating the SS at that time. And I told the Rangers that he was an SS man, and I didn't want to, I don't know what happened to him after that, and I didn't ask any questions.
Artillery comes in, or planes strafe, or they bomb, and farm animals get killed. And as you drive down the road, you smell this awful smell. And as you get closer and as you're passing by, you see these bloated cows and animals with their feet up in the air, and they stink like crazy. Now, when you get close to Dachau and you smell the stink, you disregard it. It's farm animals. It's farm animals.
Dachau, factory of horrors. Dachau, near München, one of the oldest of the Nazi prison camps. It is known that from 1941 to 1944, up to 30,000 people were entombed here at one time. And 30,000 were present when the Allies reached Dachau.
In combat, you see dead people. You see dead people. Men that fought and died, both sides. They were buried honorably and their graves marked, but these people, the stench and the smell is something you can't believe.
I was assigned to be the Colonel Bulldog's radio operator in his Jeep that particular day. See, from time to time we get, as radio operators, we get assigned you know, to different duties. You know, in that particular time, I was with Colonel Bulldog, and we wound up into this concentration camp in Dachau. They were screaming, "Americana, Americana!" They were so happy, you know, oh God, up on the roofs of the barracks and all screaming and waving. The prisoners were pointing out some of the SS troopers who had taken their uniforms off and put prisoner garb on them so that Americans would not know that they were SS troopers. But the prisoners themselves were pointing them out. And we came along a railroad site, and there was, oh, maybe 25, 30 boxcars that were open on the side, you know.
Oh my God.
We start walking along and peering through each one of them, and just all loaded with dead bodies. And we're walking along, and I thought I noticed a movement as I walked along, went like this, and did a double take, you know, and I see this hand just weakly waving like this, back and forth, weakly waving. And I don't know what, why I didn't, to this day, I don't know why I didn't jump into the boxcar to pick him up. So I called to Colonel Donald, who had already passed that car ahead of me. So I called to him. I said, "Colonel, here's a light one." They climbed into the boxcar, picked the fella up, and brought him to me. And I was at the opening, and they handed him to me. And he's just all skin and bones, poor guy. And then he looked at me, you know, big eyes, and he says, Frei. He was asking me in German if he was free. And I assured him that he was free. And you can't see the but from here, that's the back part of the boxcar. And up from here on to the opening was all dead bodies. And I was standing right here as they handed it to me. And this shot was taken behind me and above my head this way. See. And then later I heard, I didn't see it, I'm glad I didn't, a couple of our boys had taken a couple of the SS troopers and tied their hands behind their backs, shoved them in one of the furnaces that they were using to burn the bodies, pulled a pin on the hand grenade and threw it in there and slammed the door shut, walked away. But I can understand it. You see something like that and you just get so mad, your blood just boils, and wonder how such inhumanity could be done, you know. It was just a terrible day. Terrible day.
Munich was only about 9 miles from Dachau. Very close.
As I remember, we saw an awful lot of German prisoners of war with their hands over their heads or up on top of the heads. A lot of German officers would know it, but there was no fight at all in Munich. We saw an awful lot of released prisoners of war, most of which were British.
We got called into the CP. There were a couple of big German guys there, civilians, who apparently had been filtering out information to us. The civilians in Munich did not want any more problems. They didn't want to get killed. They didn't want more damage. And they were negotiating to give up, turn the town over. But these two guys knew where Hitler's house was. So we went in, this one squad of us, 12 guys, went into Munich with them.
And I don't know how we found Hitler's apartment. Somebody must have led us there, because obviously he didn't leave a forwarding address to any of us.
It wasn't even a freestanding house. This was like a brownstone. On that same street were all his offices. So this was just like, I guess if he went in to check to see how the accountant was making out, this is where he stayed. It wasn't a full-fledged big mansion, but it was a gorgeous apartment. Not apartment, a brownstone. My recollection and the recollection of some of the others who were with me was that when we banged on the door, he had an English housekeeper, a tall, stately English lady with pepper and salt hair, who called us ruffians. And she said, "Well, I don't know why everybody's so mad at Mr. Hitler. He's such a fine man."
the temptation to push her down the stairs was overwhelming. Everybody wanted a shot at that. But we went into the apartment anyway.
I ran into a bedroom, which happened to be his. I pulled open all the drawers and they were cleaned out. Incidentally, the house was furnished beautifully. The pictures were still on the wall. Everything was in great shape, but his personal stuff was gone. I went into his closet, which was also empty, and I saw something on an upper shelf. And I pulled the chair over, climbed up, and got it, and it was a beautiful top hat with initials in big gold letters, A.H. When I looked in this hat and saw A.H., I could actually see his head in the hat. And I was so pissed from the day before that I threw it on the floor, jumped off the chair, and stomped it. Immediately, I saw his head in it. Immediately, I wanted to do something to that head. Immediately, I threw it on the floor and jumped at it. That was kind of probably symbolic of what I wanted to do with him if I had him in my hands at the moment. Stomp him.
Did you just stomp with all your might? Did it?
Well, the initial damage was extreme because I jumped off the chair onto the hat. Now that's full weight on the hat. And then I stomped it a little bit more just for the hell of it. I jumped off the chair onto the hat. I continued to stomp it, foot after foot, like this here. I didn't jump up and down with both feet. I was one, you know, just stomped it like this. A couple of minutes, a minute or two, you know, that's it. It's enough.
Apparently Rich and the Dave Barr went into Hitler's house there. We didn't know it was Hitler's house. And I was outside maybe just checking around. And next thing I knew, he had this hat, and he was fooling around with it. I said, "Where'd you get it?" He said, "I got it at Hitler's house over there." And he turned it over, and there's Hitler's initials right on the band of the hat, A.H. And I thought that was really funny.
I don't know how he kept it, or where he kept it, or how. I mean, I wasn't concerned with hats. I wasn't in the clothing business, you know. I was over there. I was at war, buddy. The police dog for the platoon, you know.
I thought that was great that he had the hat. And of course he got angry with it and stomped on it. But he may even made something funny out of that. There was a collapsible, because they did make top hats that would fold up.
He held up something, and I have to think it was a comb, though. Carrying the comb into combat is the last thing I'd think of. But he had something black. And knowing Richie, he would prance up and down and make wild gestures. And I thought that was very amusing. You know, it's one of those things that you just cannot forget after having seen it.
The next memory is not really a memory. It's what Herb told me. I walked out wearing the hat and still walking around like Charlie Chaplin. That's all I can tell you, because that's as far as it goes. I don't even remember leaving the place.
Oh, this is the great dictator, Charlie Chaplin. Great film.
It was a great movie.
I loved it.
Oh, that was good.
We got Streffen, the Streffen, the Streffen!
If you haven't seen it, go ahead.
Admiral Tinkler has just said yesterday Tumania was down, but today she has risen.
This came out before we got into the war.
Because there was a lot of resentment from the German Americans.
I remember
about
that.
This,
yeah,
about
I remember
this movie.
That. I remember that.
Mocking him.
And I really didn't care.
Oh,
ladies and gentlemen, the Fuhrer's face. And is it red?
because this tuna sweeping the country, and everybody's out jeering at him. Okay.
When the Fuhrer says, here's the battery, be hail! Hail! And in the Fuhrer's face, not to love the Fuhrer, he's a great disgrace, so be hail! Hail! And in the Fuhrer's face,
beautiful!
When the Goebbels says, be on the world in space, be hail! Hail! And in her Goebbels' face, when her Goering says, they'll never bomb this place, be hail! Hail! And in her Goering's face, Harvey, not the Superman, hey, pure Superman.
Yeah, Mr. Superman.
Super duper Superman. Is this not the land so good? Would you leave it if you could?
Yeah, this not the land is good. We would leave it if we could.
We bring the world to order. Heil Hitler's world to order. Every one of four race will love the Fuhrer's face when we bring to the world disorder. When the Fuhrer says, be is the master race. Be hail! Hail! And in the Fuhrer's face, not to love the Fuhrer, is a great disgrace, so be hail! Hail! And in the Fuhrer's face, when the Fuhrer says, be is the master, be hail! Hail! And in the Fuhrer's face, not to love the Fuhrer, is a great disgrace, so be hail! Hail! Right in the Fuhrer's face.
Sid, I've got a surprise for you in this bag.
Is it safe? Whatever it is, thank you. Oh, it feels like something that I've had before. At first I thought it was a pizza. It might just as well be a pizza. Yeah, I've seen it before. That's it.
That is the hat.
When's the last time you've seen it?
That day in the Munich apartment in 1945. This looks like the hat that Harpo Marx might wear.
Great editing.
There she blows. Considering 50 years in the basement, it's still in pretty good condition, even after the stomping.
I brought it home in a duffel bag, but then I took it out of a duffel bag and I...
Yeah, the cabinet that I put it in the basement was my magic cabinet, where I also had two or three other top hats that I used for magic.
This is a magic cabinet of mine. It's full of crap. And it was down here on the bottom shelf in a paper bag.
That's
it,
right.
Like, yes. It was down there in the paper bag in the bottom shelf.
What along did with it mean to you to have like Hitler's hat like in the bottom of your magic?
Never gave it a thought. I never gave it a thought. I only work with one top hat. I only use the top hat for one item, one effect. Paper balls in the hat. That's the only thing I use it for. I don't use it for anything else.
And I think Rich said also that he found this the day before Hitler committed suicide. Yeah, and he was telling me this the other day, and he's so funny, that guy. I only remember everything that he says. He says, yeah, when Hitler heard that this little Jewish boy stepped on his hat, he committed suicide.
I still use the line.
Oh, Jesus.
Hail, 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 hail! Hail, you say!
Oh, hail, I see.
Mike, right, fear, 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 shake, crunk, I can poop it, you have
yeah? Yeah.
Deep, shake, shake, shim, shim, naya, unterwäsch, you have problem, yeah?
Yeah, man, I'm from the South, naya, unterwäsch, that's what I'm suffering from.
Yeah, man.
Damn nuts.
Yeah.
Word apparently traveled back from regiment. Maybe the colonel was talking to the general, I don't know. But that there's, you know, a guy here with Hitler's hat. And this photographer just showed up looking for me. He set me next to this chest with a mirror on it, so he got kind of a reflection of it too. That was all the photographer's idea. And
He had me put it on. The only thing, this was my idea, that was not his. That's the Hitler shot.
Heil Hitler! Heil Hitler!
Heil Hitler!
Heil Hitler! Heil Hitler! Heil Hitler! Heil Hitler!
Der Führer!
Heil Hitler!
Heil Hitler!
Heil myself.
That's a line from the producers. Heil myself.
Well, I won't even say that. See, Heil, dude.
And I don't remember seeing Mr. Hitler in this get up.
I honestly and truly believe that if this hat was in perfect condition, it wouldn't mean quite as much. I think the fact that it looks the way it does, ruined, stamped, symbolizes the fact that it's been stamped out. National Socialism was stamped out. That's what our division helped do. And I, in my own little minor little part, hope I did my share.
A one-time house painter who briefly controlled almost all of Europe, the man who caused the deaths of tens of millions, the suffering of a whole generation. Adolf Hitler thought he was leading a thousand-year Reich. He was big on ceremony, and for that, you would certainly need a top hat.
I just got an invitation through the mail. Your presence requested this evening is formal. Top hat, white tie, and tails. Nothing now could take the wind out of my sails. Because I'm invited to step out this evening in top hat, white tie, and tails. Oh, I'm putting on my top hat, tying up my white tie, brushing off my tails. I'm dudeing up my shirt front, putting in the shirt studs, polishing my nails. I'm stepping out, my dear, to breathe an atmosphere that simply reeks with class. And I trust that you'll excuse my dust when I step on the gas.
Would you like to see the inside?
Absolutely.
AH stands for other things besides Adolf Hitler.
You can say it.
I can say it? Asshole.
We knew we were winning the war when you get the Führer's hat.
He has a smaller head than I do, I guess.
Rich or Hitler?
They both do, because it doesn't fit me very well.
Lettering that's gold, yeah. There could be something.
Saul didn't believe me.
He didn't believe what? That was Hitler's hat? Oh, yeah, that's it, all right.
Yeah, it's gold. That's gold. That's gold. AH. Now, trying to figure out for what purpose he wore this hat.
Now there's what I call a hat.
Did he forget he had the hat, or was it just time to hand it over?
I'm sorry, Ed. Repeat the question. I had trouble hearing you.
I said, did he forget he had the hat all these years, or was it just time to hand it over?
No, I think he was aware of the fact that he had it. I get the impression that, you know, as for so many veterans of World War II, it certainly was not a happy experience, and for a long time it took a while to come to terms with what he had gone through, because just the day before he was in Munich, he had gone to the death camp at Dachau.
Sure, so the hat became too full of memories. Understood. Thank you, Bill Landon, live. Chris.
It stayed in the closet all those years because I did not think about I didn't think about anything that happened. I just didn't talk about it. And this was part of something that I wasn't talking about. And it wasn't until I got together with my guys in 93 that I found out that I could talk about it, because I remembered everything pretty much correctly. And I kind of got it out. I guess I had a little therapy session in 1993. And I still didn't really talk about the hat until I was asked for souvenirs for the museum. And that's when the hat actually came out, in 95.
What do the reunions mean to you? What is it like?
Oh, it's a chance to see the friends that you experienced most intense days of your life, probably. And this probably includes marriage.
At first, I know the women didn't quite understand. My wife didn't understand. Why in the world do you want to go back and be with those guys that you knew 20 years ago or 30 years ago, whatever it was? I said, I don't know, but I do, you know? And it just worked out that way. I mean, if you've been with somebody and been shot or shot at, and you grab each other and pull them back in a hole or some other, that does something to you, and you'll never forget it.
The reunion is something that no matter what happens, I got to get there. More so than ever. Because, unfortunately, you're going to be missing somebody from time to time. At the rate, at the age we are, and the rate things are going, you just want to get there at every reunion and make sure you're going to see these guys, whoever shows up.
I really,
this one first.
I really love these guys.
Okay, then you press this one.
I had better friends in my lifetime.
So it must be 11.
Guys I know longer, more intimately, but there's something about my relationship to them that is unlike any other.
One, two, three.
Enjoyed that, because it was an amazing story, and I hope that you'll maybe do a little bit more research on it. But I do want to tell you who's going to be up next week. Next week we're going to be talking about Eyes Wide Open. They're having a big fundraiser. Oktoberfest is coming up, but I think that has to do more with running. And then the Skanky Day Nursery will be on to talk about their big barbecue coming up. The Scottish Games are coming, of course they are, and the Walk for Rita, which is for suicide prevention. So we hope you'll watch us next week. Have a great day.